And that's why I put on the soft music, because I want to get into Mike Carter's conscience here. Now, I've known you for how long? Three, four months?
Yeah, like that? About that long.
Okay. As I've gotten to know Mike a little better, Mike is, you know, for attorneys get a bad rap. They say they have no soul, and they everybody tells their jokes about attorneys.
Oh, my God. Oh, yeah, yeah.
But you seem to have a soul. I mean, I heard you say one day, you don't do the family law stuff because it's so sad. It's so heartbreaking and gut-wrenching.
Yeah, that's exactly. And I lived with, not lived with, but checked up with two or three family law attorneys for a while. And, and it is. You get a guy comes in, I just caught my wife in the garage with a neighbor. And, you know, you're like, get your razor blades and we'll both, you know, go, go to town, you know.
If you hear that all day.
Oh, my God. And I wasn't the one dealing with them. I would catch me off guard on my way to the water fountain and and just get any set of ears that would start listening, you know. It's like, oh, my gosh, you know. Yeah. It is sad as heck. And they're real stories then. It's not watching a movie.
Sing it, girl.
Oh, dear. He must have heard everything. She's screaming agony.
She's not in pain. But I wonder. That's good vocals. The you're good at your job, okay? You are good at what you do. You've been doing it for a while. What happens? You have a guy sitting in front of you. Hey, Mike, I need you. This is my ninth DUI. And you know he's just a drunk son of a bitch. Uh-huh. And he's probably going to. I mean, there are differences. There are circumstances do matter.
Right.
So you have some people that, you know, are trying to earn a honest living and they screwed up.
Mm-hmm.
Damn it, you know, they knew they shouldn't have drove home that night, but they did, and they regret it. But then you got the old son of a bitch who thinks, do you ever say, you know what, no, I'm not. You may throw 10 grand at me, but I'm not taking it. My conscience says otherwise.
Yeah, it's a pretty difficult question to answer. I mean, you don't really want to turn away business, you know, at any time if you don't have to. But
and everybody has a right for their. And I agree with that. I do agree with that. But I just wondered if you've ever been in a situation where you were bothered by it, and you're like,
You know, each case is independent of all the other cases. You know, typically, as long as the defendant doesn't get on the stand, you're not going to be bringing up any of their prior offenses and that kind of thing. During sentencing, later on, there'll be a time where the judge says, this is your seventh time, you're found guilty this time, you're never coming out of jail again. But on the front end, when you meet a client, they're in a bad place. It doesn't necessarily do you. You have to manage expectations and let them know you've created some of this yourself, take some responsibility. But you don't necessarily take on a parental or didactic role and tell them to necessarily change their life, you know, because you see the forest for the trees and they don't, type of thing. But I think you could turn somebody away, and I definitely would in the event that I just felt very squeamish or bad about it. Money doesn't rule my life.
You're willing to do that if there's somebody that's just, you just don't have a good feeling about where they're, and you know you're able to get them off more than likely, and so then what's going to happen in the future? I mean, that would bother you if you knew. Well, you got somebody off, and then they did something really stupid.
In the abstract, just 5,000-foot view, you're like a Monopoly board or something. To the extent that an attorney gets a ninth-time offender, you know, a pretty good outcome, that bodes well for you in the future. You know, gaining other clients, other attorneys thinking you're decent at what you do. Prosecutors in the future knowing that you can accomplish, you know, hard objectives. And so, I mean, there is that. There's a matrices of pressures that are on you to, you know, decide if that's something you want to do and if you want to take the adventure or not.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever had a murder case?
No.
Never had a murder case?
Attorneys in our office has done and does do those. I'm not real fond of the murder spectrum of clients.
But, the gore and all that stuff.
But I want everyone to have their right to a good, adequate defense attorney or 5 or 10 when they're accused of something. That's the way our system works, you know, beyond a reasonable doubt, and there are mistakes made. We know it. You know, this
Innocence
Justice
Project.
Yeah, the Innocence Project the past 20 years is showing that we've got people in jail that have lived a bad life who should not have.
And not be there. Yeah, but the guy we interviewed, that dude that was in prison for, what was it, 21 years?
Mm-hmm.
I'd be pissed.
Were you ever a public defender?
I wasn't. Another attorney in our office, Ruth Barrett, she was a public defender for a good long time, and
I've heard
another
heard
one I worked with, and Emily Kaiser, they both were friends, and
Is she a little short lady, right?
Ruth Barrett?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she's
black
real,
hair,
I've heard
about
she's
our age.
Really kick ass in the courtroom.
Hmm.
That's what I've heard.
What about in the bedroom?
No clue. No clue. She's got a good life partner named James to tell us all about it. We can call him up.
Okay, let's give him a call.
But she is really good. And that experience as a public defender, I mean, you have no resources. You got 1,000 files. And you got clients that want the stars and the moon.
Uh-huh.
You learn really quick how to deal with, you know, very difficult circumstances.
I guess my question is if you're in a case, murder or whatnot, one of the more serious cases, and you're fed down a line like, I didn't do it. And then all of a sudden they go, you know what, man? Check it out. I did do it.
Right, right.
Can you drop them at that point? Or are you like, oh, my, thanks
you
a
have
lot.
To get, now.
If you're the attorney of record, you have to get permission from the court. And it would probably be
denied.
You know, it might not be denied if the court was convinced that you were going to be inadequate in your assistance of counsel to them because of your position now mentally or something. You might be able to get off the case. But a lot of times, if you're a public defender, you do not have that option at all.
I've watched a lot of these movies. That's the only experience I have with this whole legal thing.
Right, and those are always exactly how real life works.
Right. No, that's what I'm saying. They're I'm sure, I know they're not, but I'm wondering, like in this, I remember this one movie with Keanu Reeves where he was a great attorney and the power.
Devil's Advocate?
Yeah. You know, it started to get to his head, like with his, you ever, with your wife, you ever, because you get so used to being in the courtroom, getting things done your way, you ever treat her like she's a juror or
witness?
No, but they teach you in law school right away. You know, we're teaching you from day one. We're teaching you a new way to think and talk. You know, if you used to be a poet, you're not going to have any finesse anymore. It's going to be black, white,
yes,
gray, and
yes,
convince him or her, even if you're on the wrong side of the battle, and try not to bring that home to Thanksgiving dinner. But it is tough.
I mean,
and I think people do start to. I remember my Aunt Donna came to work for me, who I've loved my whole life. We used to sneak popcorn and sodas into the theater, and we got to work.
My God, what's next? Heroin dealing?
That's the memories I have of her.
That's what you jump to.
The popcorn.
And then it's heroin.
Yeah, the needles.
Right after that.
It was warm and cozy, but she started telling me, she's like, you don't trust anybody. And, you know, you got to give some people a little slack. But back to the wife question, she's told me several times, you know, I'm not one of your clients. I'm not a judge. Shut the heck up. And I think she's put me in my place for long enough. I got it.
She humbles you.
Reined in. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. A couple of text things here real quick that came in that I wanted to hit because I promised him I would. One of them is about a suspended license in the state of Missouri. I guess there's a lot of that.
Been there.
Do you?
Tons of it.
So that's not that hard to get taken care of.
Well, in fact, many times people call us on a Monday at 12 o'clock and they don't have a license. And by Friday, we've got them driving legally. It's not always that easy. But, you know, with the 96 municipal courts here around here, you can usually, if you're paid enough, one, that sounds bad, to run around and bring all the things together that it takes, you can usually get somebody back under control pretty quick.
And this is one from O'Fallon, Missouri, that has to do with apartments. Real quick, I don't know how much real estate law you actually do know a lot of real estate.
I'm on the board of directors at the real estate board now, and I've been a broker since 1990 and done a lot of real estate stuff. I know that enough to be dangerous for certain.
They're in O'Fallon, and they want to know: can you be evicted? There's no past due rent money, but can you be evicted for late fees that are unpaid?
And we talked, I've talked to someone about this not too long ago. It can occur if you've got a repetitious behavior of always being late and it's causing, you know, an undue hardship potentially on the landlord, and the lease addresses that. It's potentially the case with a straight face, you could bring that to court. But most judges in Missouri, if they filed a rent and possession action trying to get you out, and they come to court and they say, you owe $180 in late fee, the judge is going to be like, but your rent is paid up? And if they say yes, the judge is going to be probably mad and dismiss the case, and you're going to be living there anyway.
Right. So, yeah, not a huge deal unless it's a bunch of them.
Well, I don't understand why if you, from the landlord's point of view, if I have not paid rent in 4 months, why is it so hard to kick a family or someone out of a house or an apartment?
Well, you've...
Depends on the situation.
Gained a possessory right. You know, the property's a bundle of sticks, and one of those sticks is possession, and they've got a right to exclude people from that property, even the landlord, once you engage in that.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're all sensitive to things that happen in life that make you not able to pay a rent or whatever, and to just kick you out, you know, the second day that you're late or something like that, we as a society or through our legal bodies, the General Assembly and the governor and them, have decided that there's some due process rights that you have to have in place before someone can formally make a sheriff come and start moving your stuff out to
right.
the curb.
Right.
I have a question about divorce. If you are on the same terms...
It's about time you get one,
I was
Stacey.
About to say.
It's about time.
You're not even married, are you?
I've never even walked down the aisle in a white dress.
Oh, whatever. You will
one day. I've been a bridesmaid 23 times.
In the words of Baba
Booey.
Never
been a bride.
Whatever,
Listerine
dude.
Used to have a commercial about that, remember?
Who did?
Listerine. When I taught marketing, it was a picture of a lady standing by a Listerine bottle if you only had good breath. You know, always a bridesmaid, never a bride.
Good breath. Good Lord. Cheap shot.
Cheap shot
no,
Carter.
No, it just reminded me.
That's what they call
of
him.
Yeah,
not, no, I'm not. I've only known you.
You whatever, dude.
Hey, no, I'm totally
You go down to the county courthouse, and when he walks in, they all yell, cheap shot Carter. Hey,
right.
CSC.
Right. Yeah. Anyway,
I should think those things through. I'm sorry, dude.
You're on Stacy's bad side now.
No.
Join the crowd.
Everybody
that.
Is.
I love you all.
Everybody is.
You're like my brothers.
What does your favorite fan always say?
Which you know, one?
Your lady that likes to
Grace
scream out.
Stacey, right?
Yeah. Yeah, here that she one? Is. I think I've got her right over
what
here.
What was your question about
the
yeah.
best.
That's her.
She's Did you play that one guy who was saying that goofy stuff at the morgue earlier? What was that little statement you kept playing over about the...
I don't know.
What was he saying?
It was very Cajun.
I was really trying to figure out what it was.
Yeah, that's yeah, you're like not a, going to.
Sound like a Nevin Daddy. No.
What? I think he was saying, I'm about to put some voodoo hex on your ass.
I think so, he was.
I wondered if it was another local show that he was referring
oh,
to.
No. Oh, no.
Nevin Daddy, Nevin Daddy.
All right.
He was mush mouth. Okay, so I have a friend who's legally separated.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And is going to be divorcing like in February-ish.
Okay. That's when all of them are filed. You know that, right? No one gets divorced in Thanksgiving and Christmas. The most filings for divorce are in February
really?
Every year, right?
Really?
Okay, well, anyway, I don't know what that has to do with my question, though.
It has a lot to do with it.
This made me think.
Oh, okay. So, they are on the same page, supposedly, of they're just going to get a separation. I'm sorry, a divorce without contesting anything.
Yeah.
Do you have to have an attorney for that?
No.
Yeah, I mean,
how do you know?
You're talking to an attorney. Yeah, so.
What's Eric doing answering over here? Are you a part-time lawyer?
I was just trying to
Are you working for Cheap Shot Carter on the side?
Yeah, really.
Is that what you're doing?
Johnson.
A large percentage of uncontested or supposedly non-contested divorce proceedings turn into contested pretty quickly.
I think,
so that's the danger. And I do have a friend. He's created his own bill through the state legislature. He started his own company. He does well. And he came to me asking the same question. And I said, dude, I would never do it if you're asking my opinion without an attorney. He did it. Him and his wife, uncontested. Took him 6 months. I don't know why so long. There's only a 30-day cooling off and everything. But he got it done. You know, and he saved all that money, all the $2,500 or whatever it would have been to possibly do it right, in my opinion. But
$2,500 to get divorced?
I think if you're really going to explore all the options...
It costs me $10,000 to get a paternity suit.
Well, like uncontested, I mean. If it really remains that way, just to uncover and everybody be on the same page, you know?
Stacey was so excited when she got her first paternity suit.
But the second one...
$10,000. He is the father. Son of a...
Did you do it on Maury Povich?
Yes. Eight times.
How did they have drive-through divorces out in Vegas? Do you remember those?
I've heard about them like everybody has, but... I don't know. I don't know if you could. They have
Such
usually
a weirdo
there's a cooling
state.
Off period of 30 days in almost all the states I'm aware of. So
what does that mean, cooling off period?
Where you come together and you think you're gonna get divorced and
the
court
down.
Says you need 30 days to figure out maybe you can actually work it out. That's what the state statute.
They don't care.
Did you hear us prank?
Wow.
The lawyer yesterday. I mean, you were probably in court or doing something really important.
I saw you called 895-4040. Right?
I
happened to be there by chance, and she said, "I think that's the." The snake or whatever.
The snake.
That's
DC's
new nickname. I heard that commercial.
Was she calling me?
DC's new nickname. The
Sniper.
Well,
Viper.
You and I said nice things about her.
You dirty snake.
And she's calling me the snake.
No. She started catching on, she got nervous. She for whatever reason.
She did jump right in and say, "I can't answer legal questions."
But she was about to, though.
She sounds cute, though.
Wasn't.
She sounds cute.
We called at like 8 o'clock to make sure that if we were in jail, would they answer? Would you guys answer?
Oh, No question. 8 to 6, you're in good hands.
What happens if you're in jail at 1 a.m.?
I visited a guy the other night for a couple hours. He was on a 12-hour hold, and I just went and sat with him for about 2 hours and talked.
Did you hold his hand?
Was he pickled?
It's a nice
was he pickled?
No, no. He was wrong. He had a trooper that's only about 6 months old on the force.
6 months old.
That's like my
pharmacist. I think they graduated
Hire
together.
Him out of high school.
No, I mean that they didn't know what they were doing. It was evident. And I don't think he should have been where they were when I went to visit him because it was done improperly, but I'll get all that.
That was nice of you to go visit.
Yeah.
At one
of
the
morning. Was.
Yeah, it eats up. I don't know if you heard about a 12-hour hold in St. Charles County, but you're on a bench.
I've been there.
And you're handcuffed. You're not in a cell with a mat and a bench.
It sucks. You're
handcuffed to a bench for 12 hours.
It's co-ed.
That's what's up with that.
The only thing is that you get some exciting people come in and out past you. You can watch some fireworks.
Oh, yeah.
God damn it. Sorry about that. Gosh darn it, Mike.
What is up with that?
The holding cell is the place to be.
It's a lot better if you want to sleep. But if you want action and you want to watch the people come through all night, it's not as bad.
Yeah, hang out. Yeah.
Entertainment-wise, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. I've never been on the bench, but I've heard it in trial. It comes up a lot. So you're on the bench for 10 hours, you know?
Man.
Wow.
Your back gets hurt. You can't lay on the floor. You can't lay on the bench.
I think you can kneel if you're close to one end of it or something. I've never seen it, actually. Just heard it.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
Total hearsay.
That sounds like the worst.
That's cruel and unusual.
It is.
It depends. It's better. For some people, they much prefer it rather than dressing out in orange. You know what I mean? You don't have to dress out. You're in your regular clothes.
Do they let you choose? Would you like the bench or would you like a cell?
I feel like if it's all cotton orange, I would like the
If you know enough to ask, I think they will let you choose.
Really?
They don't offer it up. Mm.
But if you know.
Take the orange and I would like my egg biscuit in the morning as well.
Yes.
Right.
No, it's a piece of bologna on hard bread.
It's not
true. In O'Fallon, I got breakfast from Burger King.
Did you?
Yeah. No lie.
Is there a Westplex municipality you haven't been through? St. Charles, O'Fallon.
Sad but true.
What's it like in St. Peter?
I've been there. It's very small. But they got a brand new police department, so I don't know about the updated facilities, but 8 years ago, whenever I was arrested,
I heard Wentzville's real nice.
Yeah, the St. Peter's one's a palace. I wonder if they like serve you filet mignon. That place is nice.
What's not nice is that Forestdale. That's not nice.
It's not.
It's like a dog cage, isn't it?
Oh, no, it's a trailer.
In Cool Valley, they have a dog cage you can't stand up in. You sit on a thing, and it's a cage made out of fence.
I got pulled over one time.
On a bench, yeah.
I was going out there. Yeah, in Forestdale, one time.
Me too.
I was going
in a cage too, don't they?
Court is a trailer. It's like a mobile home.
I was going out there, and Earl is the judge.